pop quiz. How do you win a game where every time you score, you immediately give a goal away? Answer, you don't. Avs lose the Vegas Golden Knights 8-4 in game one of the season. I have COVID, I'm covered in water, and the Avs just got blown out in the first game of the season, so I hope your season started better than mine did. I would love to sit here and tell you that it's only game one and that this doesn't matter at all and that it's a long season and the Avs will be fine. And I do believe that very last bit, but this game is the regular season. This game does matter. There were 2 points on the line, and the Avs didn't even really get close to winning them. There are glaring issues for Colorado up and down the lineup in this game, and I will get into all of them. Unfortunately, the most glaring one of them in this game was goaltending. The Avs only gave up 21 shots in this game, and they got scored on 8 times. Take away the empty netter, that's 7 goals on 20 shots with an actual goalie in net. That's a .650 save percentage combined. Georgiev was absolutely brutal. 5 goals on 16 shots against. Yeah, some of them were high danger. Yeah, some of them were very, very poorly defended. I'm going to get into that. You still got owned. The Avs faced 4 total high danger shots against in this game, and 3 of them ended up in your back of your net. It's a 25% save percentage on high danger chances. Pretty bad, but sure, those are high danger chances. They're supposed to go in more of the time, right? That still means Georgiev gave up 2 low danger chance goals too. And the worst part of this is, Georgiev's numbers are actually better than Justus Annunen's, who came in the third period, and only managed to muster a .500 save percentage, 2 goals against on 4 shots against. You just can't be okay with that level of goaltending, no matter what the team in front of them looks like. The craziest part of this game is through the first 10 minutes, the Avs actually looked really good. They were generating quality chances, controlling play, and not giving up a ton. The few dangerous-ish chances they gave up were stopped by Georgiev in the early parts of this game. Here is maybe the biggest positive out of this game. It looks like the Avs are getting the shooting version of Mikko Rantanen this season. I'm going to give Mikko a lot of deserved praise for shooting in this video, but he also does a lot more work than that. Look at him in the corner with the puck. He's the man who battles, wins this battle, and ultimately gets the Avs going on this play. He's able to spin to the middle and create some space by shoveling that out to MacKinnon. The Avs don't get anything set up without that. Goes back up to Toews, slides back down to MacKinnon. MacKinnon is able to find the gap to hit Mikko here. MacKinnon's got a lot of skill too, and Mikko is ready. He's ready to get this puck and unload a bomb to get the Avs on the board. That was only the beginning of the night for Mikko, really, but the guy is just too good of a shooter to not take advantage of that thing. He would end the night with 6 shots on goal. 3 of them would obviously go in, and that's why I'm covered in water. Good. More of that, Mikko. Great. And if I'm being honest, Mikko is maybe the top player that I don't really have a problem with in this game. Pretty much everyone else had some egregious errors going on as far as the Avs' top line and the Avs' top pairing. Unfortunately, the other big problem in this game, and I shouldn't say other, there were a bunch, but goaltending probably number one. Number two, every single time the Avs scored, Vegas scored one back within 2 minutes. It's a pretty routine offensive zone setup for Vegas. Nothing crazy here initially. You can see the Avs are marked up pretty well. 1, 2, 3 across the deep part of their own zone. And they have Colton, and I can't see who that other forward is, paired up with a defenseman up high. So nothing that crazy. You do get a puck in behind the net that DeHaan isn't really able to pressure Olofsson on at all. And Olofsson does a pretty typical move here. Strong on the puck, cuts back up the boards. DeHaan doesn't handle it super well, but nothing too crazy. He's not given up enough space that a cut to the net is a real problem here. He's able to keep Olofsson along the wall for the most part, and Olofsson's just going to take a tough angle shot here. Does Georgiev have a little bit of a screen in front of him here? Yeah, he sure does, but he plays this as wrong as you can play it. He drops down and starts to slide to the middle of the ice, predicting a pass through the middle of the ice, which isn't coming. There's just a shot up high, and credit to Olofsson, this is a very good shot, but Georgiev actively moves himself out of the way of this puck. Look, that is a nice shot from Olofsson, but a short side goal from a tough angle is never a good one for a goalie. And honestly, from there, Vegas had a little bit of pushback, but it looks like it's developing into a good game. It's 1-1 with 2 minutes left in the first period. I feel like the Avs have probably played the better period to that point, but it's nothing free in the NHL. And then the Avs, or more specifically Nathan MacKinnon, makes two pretty bad mistakes. Vegas breaking the puck out here. I actually think MacKinnon did a good job of initially forechecking on Eichel there. He made him cut wide, make him make decisions. A nice little zone entry play from Vegas, though, gets them around Drouin and set up into the zone. And this is where Nathan MacKinnon just loses me. As this is set up, Nathan MacKinnon is the center, and he is right now the F3. He is the deepest forward in the offensive zone, meaning he's going to have the most defensive responsibility. He's the guy who needs to cover guys cutting in deep in the zone, while the other two forwards in Mikko and Drouin are going to take the high men, most likely the defensemen along the blue line. Instead of doing anything defensively responsible, Nathan MacKinnon just chases the puck for pretty much the rest of this shift. Now, I could be wrong. Maybe this isn't MacKinnon's fault. Maybe this is Jonathan Drouin's fault, and there's supposed to be a switch here where Drouin rotates down as the low forward as MacKinnon comes up and challenges. But if that's the case, there's certainly no communication within the two. It certainly seems like Drouin is expecting MacKinnon to have circled back here and become the F3. He hasn't. So Drouin is standing there, defending for a shot against the high man, and MacKinnon initially is chasing the forward, or the defenseman up high, and then realizes, oh god, I'm supposed to be the F3, my guy is over here, I am nowhere near him. So he starts to head back, but it's a pretty casual skate around Jonathan Drouin, and this puck is already about to be on its way to the open man. Nathan MacKinnon covering nothing. Yeah, that's a pretty high danger chance. I could be convinced that some of the blame on that coverage falls onto Jonathan Drouin instead of Nathan MacKinnon, but I just don't know where Nathan MacKinnon is going on the majority of that defensive play. This alone is a frustrating goal, one that the Avs should not be happy with, but to give up another one before the end of the period? Disastrous. The Avs are going to lose this puck deep in the Vegas zone. It really shouldn't have been that big of a deal. The Avs should be okay here, but they are not. They should be. Let's be honest. This should be fine. You have your two defenders back, and you have Nathan MacKinnon even-footed in a foot race. How often do you see Nathan MacKinnon lose a foot race in the NHL with straight-line speed? Well, you're about to, as... look at this. Those are 2 feet sitting together, not skating. The guy with the puck, Jack Eichel, feet moving, skating. It's just a couple of seconds at the blue line. Nathan MacKinnon looks to his right and realizes, oh god, I got caught sleeping, but it's too late. Devon tries to get over and cover Eichel, but MacKinnon being behind the play leaves the backside open and Stone finishes. Nathan MacKinnon is one of the fastest skaters in the NHL. There's just no way he should be getting beat on a back check like that where he's even with his opponent to start the race. Taves should probably have more effectively played the pass there instead of charging the shooter. He can't really let that pass get through. Of course, maybe he expects Nathan MacKinnon to be there, so fair enough. But more than anything, it's just the mental lapses from the Avs' best players. You are 90 seconds from getting out of this period 1-1 and feeling pretty good about it, if we're honest. And now you have a two-goal hole because you just let it slip. I'm not going to get into detail on calls or no calls. There were some no calls and calls that were a bit iffy on both ends of this game for both teams. I thought it was reasonably fair. It's not something to talk about here. And I'm not going to get into specifics on Georgiev goal by goal. I stated that it was bad at the start, and I'm going to leave it at that. Okay, so the Avs made lives hard on themselves. Unfortunately, that's an all-too-common thing this last couple of seasons, but hey, at least they're used to it. They come out in the second period pretty quickly, draw a penalty, and their power play, another bright spot of the night, it gets them one goal back. Unless this is your first Avs game, this goal needs no introduction. Avs on the power play, working the umbrella, this puck is eventually going to come back up high to Cale Makar. Mikko, honestly, maybe a little bit deeper. You usually see him around the actual faceoff dot here, but he still sets him up for the beauty one-timer that he's so good at, and he finishes it. The Mikko one-timer on the power play, something we didn't see nearly enough of last season. Love to see it working, love to see it back, keep using it. You know what would be a shame? If 90 seconds later, the Avs blew another defensive coverage and got scored on, a dumped in puck that Vegas is able to chip back up the wall. Credit to Mark Stone. He takes a hit to make a play there. That's just good stuff. But you can see the Avs are pretty darn sloppy on their back check. Cal Ritchie just getting beat cleanly by his man there causes chaos in the Avalanche's defensive structure as three players collapse to Eichel with the puck. And maybe more importantly, Kovalenko floating to the middle of the ice. I know, generally, if you don't know where to go, that's probably a good place to be. But as this play develops, and the Avs have now committed four players to this quadrant of the ice, honestly, five, you could sort of count Manson in that quadrant too, you left a ridiculous amount of space open on the far side. A pretty easy pass over to White Cloud gives him a mile to walk in and finish this play. On the one hand, yeah, Kovalenko probably cheats a little bit too far to the middle there and gives a ton of room on that far side. On the other hand, at least you can look at Olofsson and say that's a good shooter. That's what he does best. Well, my camera glitched out and corrupted the second half of this recording, so that's on par for the game. But I'm a little bit drier now, and as I was saying, at least for someone like Olofsson, if he scores there, which he will later in this game, he's a really good shooter. That's the expectation. Someone like Zach Whitecloud is far from an elite shooter. You're gonna need a save there, at least sometimes against guys like that. So the Avs continue to trail by two, and the middle portion of the second period was honestly mostly a nothing burger. Not a whole lot happens, a bunch of sludgy, sloppy hockey, maybe not all that unexpected for a first game of the season, but certainly benefiting the team ahead by two. Later on in the period, though, the Avs do break through again to get it within one, and this time it comes off of a great move from Jared Bednar. A pretty little breakout pass here from Kovalenko. He's not going to get a point on this play, but it starts with him as he threads a needle to get Ross Colton going. Colton then goes to the middle, kind of battles his way through, but is able to control the puck and get the Avs in offensive zone possession. He finds Mittelstadt in below the net. Mittelstadt holds, doesn't do anything fancy, just gets a puck up high, but the Avs are set up. They're able to create an opportunity out of this. Girard, a little flick play on net, looking for a rebound or a tip. He gets the first of those two options as a rebound springs out, and Casey had been sliding to the back door, very aware of the play development. He's able to find this puck, and with hands like his, being on the backhand side is not a detriment. So obviously, first of all, great read and great hands by Casey Mittelstadt to get that goal, but the big change here was that was Ross Colton's first shift with the Avs' second line. Bednar moved Cal Ritchie off of that line, who Cal Ritchie really did not have that good of a game tonight. On the forward side, on the offensive side, I thought he had a couple of good chances, but you could kind of tell he had some first game jitters, missed the net on some decent opportunities where it just looked like he was nervous. That's not that big of a deal. On the other side of the ice, though, it was a bit of a struggle defensively for Ritchie. Even when he would make a nice play with a good back check, it seems like he would ultimately make a mistake to follow up with that by turning over a puck or having a bad defensive coverage. It was just rough. He looked lost at times in the defensive zone, and that's gonna have to improve quickly. But looking at the positive here, Colton moving up to that second line immediately produces quality effects for the Avs, and it's a good thing long-term even too, not just the immediate goal, as Colton being an effective utility knife can move up and down the lineup a little bit and give the Avs a lot more flexibility. For what it's worth, I also thought Kovalenko had a pretty solid game, even if he does make a bit of a mistake on one of these goals coming up here. So, we've already covered the one thing you definitely shouldn't do after scoring a goal, and that's giving up a goal. The next thing you shouldn't do, number two, taking a penalty. The Avs do number two, and it leads to number one. Not shown in this highlight, over a minute ago, Cale Makar fanned on an easy clearing attempt that would have gotten the Avs out of this situation. Instead, they're exhausted with the power play winding down, and it costs them. With no legs left, it's hard to keep up on a penalty kill, and especially as a new player, what ultimately breaks down here is as this puck comes out high, you're going to see Parker Kelly just set himself in the middle of the ice. Again, a lot of the time, not a bad place to set up, but with the Avs, particularly with their penalty kill system, they ask players to cover a lot of ground, and Kelly just seemingly forgets about the backside of the ice here. He's not ready to adjust. He certainly doesn't seem to think that that's his man, but by all intents and purposes, it probably should be, and that gives Olofsson a ton of room to set up and finish a play. A new guy getting a little bit lost in the systems for a penalty kill where they're exhausted? Yeah, that doesn't surprise me. But I'm not really blaming anyone here for this one. The real problem is don't take that penalty in the first place. And, you know, have your best defenseman actually clear the puck. On the one hand, the Avs make their life extremely hard for themselves in this game. But on the other, they do deserve some credit for continuing to battle. They just kept pushing, kept getting that one goal difference back, kept being right there to have a chance to win this game. They just couldn't get a save. You get into the third period and Mikko completes the hat trick to get the Avs back within one again. With a power play winding down here, Makar is going to try and laser a shot through, but it gets blocked. A good job by Girard to find a rebound and set up a secondary opportunity that comes all the way out to Makar. Makar has the space. Vegas has over-collapsed. He's walking into it, but Makar is just one step ahead. Instead of pulling this trigger, he sees a wide open Mikko Rantanen in his spot ready for another one. It's a hat trick of one-timers for Mikko. The hat trick is cool, but Makar deserves a lot of credit on this play. To be able to make that read and execute to set up Mikko for that play instead of tunneling in and taking the shot himself there is not a thing a lot of defensemen can do. That's why he's one of the elite ones in the league. And I think this is another good point to follow up with here. Yes, MacKinnon is at fault for some of these goals against. I think Kale Makar is probably at fault for that power play goal against with the failed clear. At least some of the fault falls on them. Obviously, all goals are everyone. The whole team is at fault to a certain extent. But they also help make up for some of their mistakes by finding goals and producing on the other side. Now, they're elite players. They need to do more than just go even by picking up goals for the ones they give up. But it's that part of the game that doesn't make this a complete disaster for the Avs' top players, as opposed to something like the goaltending falling apart behind them. Anyway, the Avs scored a goal, so Vegas has to score a goal. About 90 seconds later, Devon Taves takes not a single, but a double minor for a high stick, and Vegas does not wait around. Just 5 seconds in, they get their goal. Avs lose the faceoff on the penalty kill clean here, and you get a little bit of a pick play in the middle, which causes Parker Kelly to just stick with that man instead of coming out and challenging Jack Eichel more aggressively. Eichel's just going to unleash a shot from the top of the circle and score. I don't work in the NHL. I think it would be pretty cool to do that, but I'm sure I would get fired in about 2 seconds if I did, but something high on my list would probably be covering Jack Eichel on the penalty kill. I take it back. It was deflected by Mark Stone. That's going to be hard to stop. And the game was basically over at that point. The Avs weren't going to have another muster of a comeback in them from there. Vegas does add their 7th goal that you see happening now with a nice little move from Barbashev and then a backhand goal that, don't get me wrong, it's a sick shot, but another one that you would probably like to see a goalie stop if everything goes perfectly. An empty netter gets you to your 8-4 final, and that final score is what it is. I do think there are some good underlyings here for the Avs. The Avs actually didn't play that bad of a game. Again, they only gave up 21 shots to Vegas. It's just that 8 of them went in the net. There were not really any stretches of this game where Vegas dominated. There were stretches where they pushed back or maybe had the majority of control, but honestly, it all just boils down to everything going in. You had 3 defensemen, Calvin DeHaan, Sam Alinsky, and Josh Manson, all have 0 high danger chances against at 5-on-5. They were playing some quality defense for good portions of this game. Malinsky and DeHaan both had 1 goal go in while they were playing well defensively, and Manson had 2, and there's just nothing he can do about that. I thought Josh Manson had a very good game. He was playing physically effective, playing quality defense, even pitched in with an assist on the score sheet. I think you got a perfect Josh Manson game out of this one. The Avs just could not survive their mistakes and could not get a save. The reality of the Avs goaltending is it's not going to be this bad in net every single night. Doesn't matter who's in net, it's just not going to be this bad every time. But they just shortened their leashes by a ton with this game. It's too early to really hit a panic button about one game, but it's not too early to say, hey, if this doesn't get cleaned up very fast, be ready for something different. It's going to be what it's going to be unless the Avs front office decides to do something about it. If and when that happens, then we can talk about it. But until that point, you're just going to have to deal with what it is on a night-to-night basis and look at other areas to improve, because there's nothing more to say about the goalie situation. Everything about it was talked about last season. Every single thing we said still applies, and that's just the reality of it. So instead of continuing that conversation and having the same argument night in and night out, let's actually look at the things they can improve in front of their goaltending. Simply, the Avs' best players have to be more effective defensively. On the flip side, the Avs' power play looked very, very good tonight. I know technically they went 1-for-3, but really they went 2-for-3. So that's a nice little feather in their cap. You got production out of their second line, which is critical for this team, especially early in this season. And your star players looked great, at least in the offensive end of the ice. It's a disappointing way to start the season. There is no doubt about that. I don't have any long-term concerns about the on-ice play of the skaters. And while looking bad and not getting 2 points to start off the year is not a good thing, I think they'll be just fine. They really could have done me a solid and had a better game for this one, though. That is the end of this game video review. Thank you for watching. Head on over to thednvr.com for all of our coverage. I am Rudo, and I cannot do another year of yelling about goalies.